Hi, this is Ajay Anand. Welcome to Science Classes from excelup.com. In this video, you will be learning about our environment. You will learn about the ecosystem, about food chain and food web, about energy transfer through subsequent trophic levels, and you will also learn about the depletion of ozone layer. Let us start with the ecosystem. What is ecosystem? Ecosystem is a system of interdependency between living beings and non-living things in a given geographical area. Let us try to understand this definition. So, ecosystem, say for example, this is an ecosystem. So, there is a river or pond, then there is some grassland, there are some animals and plants. So, these are the living beings. Then there is sunlight, air, water, soil. These are non-living things. So, an ecosystem has two components, biotic component and abiotic components. The living beings, they form the biotic component. So, animals, plants and microbes, they are the biotic components. And non-living things, for example, sunlight, air, water and soil, they comprise the abiotic component. Biotic components, they can be divided into three categories. One is called producer, then consumer, and decomposer. The green plants and some bacteria, they make their own food, and that is why they are called producer, because the food prepared by them is utilized for by other living beings. Then there are consumers. Consumers are those living beings which do not make their own food, rather they depend on green plants or other autotrophs for food. So animals, herbivores or carnivores, they are the consumers. What happens when an animal or a plant dies? The dead remains of animals and plants, they are taken care of by the decomposers. They are the microbes like fungi or some bacteria. They convert the dead remains into simple inorganic substances so that the inorganic substances or the raw materials, they can be recycled back to the nature. So, this shows the interdependency between living things and non-living things. So, the inorganic materials, the raw materials, they are utilized by green plants to produce biomass. After that, the animals, they depend on plants for food, and the microbes, they recycle everything back to the nature. Okay. Now, so you have seen that animals, they eat plants, and some plants eat animals. So there is a food chain, that is a chain of prey and predator. Here is an example of a simple food chain. It has three levels: producer, primary consumer and secondary consumer. So the grass is a producer, a rabbit, that is an herbivore, is a primary consumer, and a fox is a carnivore, it's a secondary consumer. So this is the relationship which is shown through a food chain. So this is a simple example, this is a linear example, but nature does not offer such simple examples. There can be so many food chains. A particular plant can be eaten by so many herbivores. Some animals can be eaten by so many carnivores. So there are many interlinked chains in the nature. So this makes a complex web of food chain, and this is called food web. So for example, here are the plants. It can be eaten by a rabbit, some insects, a goat. These insects, they can be eaten by a bird or a frog or even by a snake. The rabbit, it can be eaten by the snake, it can be eaten by the fox. The snake can be eaten by an owl. The goat can be eaten by a lion. So there are so many prey and predators. So this is a food web. What happens in food web? When we rise through subsequent level, for example, producers, primary consumers, secondary consumers, they are called trophic levels. The trophic has come from the word trophos, as you have seen in heterotrophic or autotrophic. So trophos is related to nutrition. So when a herbivore eats a plant, it gets energy in the form of food, and this energy, it has come from the sun. Okay, so let us see how the energy is channelized through different trophic levels. What happens, of all the energy which is falling on the leaves of a green plant, just 1% of it is utilized to convert it and gets converted into food. Okay, now whatever food the green plant gets, it has to do certain work like respiration and other works. So, and some of the energy that is also wasted in the form of heat. So, 90% of the energy which the organism at a particular trophic level receives, it utilizes 90% of energy for its own work. So, it leaves just 10% of the energy to make a biomass, and this 10% is available as food for the organisms of next trophic level. And same thing happens here also. Say, for example, if a herbivore eats something, 90% of the energy or food is utilized for its own purposes, and just 10% is left for the living being at the secondary consumer level. So, this is a rule of 10%. So, by the time we reach this level, the tertiary consumer level, a minuscule amount of energy of what was received at this level is left for the consumption of the organisms at this level. And that is why in most of the cases, we usually see three trophic levels, and very rarely we see 4 trophic levels, but more than 4 trophic levels, they are impossible because of the diminishing percentage of energy as we move subsequently through different trophic levels. And that's why the population of herbivore is always the greatest in an ecosystem, followed by the population of primary consumers, then population of secondary consumers is even less, and the population of tertiary consumer is minuscule compared to the population of the herbivores. And that is how the ecosystem works. So, it was all about ecosystem. Now, let us talk about ozone depletion. Ozone is present in stratosphere of atmosphere, and that is why the stratosphere is also called the ozone layer. Ozone layer plays an important role. It prevents harmful ultraviolet radiations from entering the Earth's surface, because ultraviolet radiation, they can cause skin cancer and they can cause many other problems for the living beings at the troposphere. Now, let us see how ozone is being formed. When ultraviolet radiation, it acts on oxygen, it breaks the oxygen molecule into oxygen atoms. So, one molecule of oxygen, it breaks into 2 atoms of oxygen. Now, one of these atoms, it combines with a molecule of oxygen to form ozone, that is O3, and that is how the ozone layer is formed. This process goes on continuously. Now, because of the development of science and technology, we developed many products which use a group of compound that is called CFC. CFC stands for chlorofluorocarbon. CFCs are used in refrigerant, aerosol spray and fire retardant. When CFCs, they are released in atmosphere, they react with ozone, and the reaction results in breakup of ozone to form oxygen molecules. So, excess use of CFC, it resulted in a hole in ozone layer over Antarctica. It is not exactly a hole, but the layer was depleted enough, it became thin enough to allow ultraviolet radiation inside the earth so that it could reach the earth's surface, and this resulted in growing cases of skin cancer. So, alarmed by this incident, United Nations Environment Program, it convinced the member countries to come to an agreement, and the agreement it materialized in 1987. The agreement was to phase out CFC from different all the countries. Nowadays, the CFC, it has been not in use in most of the countries, okay, and the results they are highly encouraging. So, because of negligible use of CFCs now, ozone layer, it has been repaired to a great extent, but we still need to take care and we still need to avoid the use of chlorofluorocarbons, okay. So, I talked about the ecosystem and talked about the biotic component and abiotic component. I talked about food chain and food web. Then I talked about the flow of energy through subsequent trophic levels. And at the end of the video, I talked about how ozone is formed, role of ozone layer, and the effect of CFCs on ozone layer. That's all. Thank you.